Swaziland, which is Africa's last absolute monarchy, chairs SADC for a year. It will be assisted by South Africa and Botswana, and South Africa will then take over from Swaziland next year, and it will host the next SADC summit in 2017. On the security side, SADC security organ will be chaired by Tanzania, taking over from Mozambique, assisted by Angola as incoming chair for 2017. Interestingly, Tanzania's President John Magufuli didn't attend the SADC summit in Swaziland. He sent Vice President Hassan instead. This is the second SADC summit that President Magufuli is skipping since he became president. And it, of course, raises questions around the vigor at which Tanzania will provide strategic leadership at the SADC security organ. There are questions, too, around Swaziland's leadership of SADC, but, of course, for completely different reasons. While its head of state, King Mswati, is a regular at SADC summits, Swaziland's role as chair has been under the spotlight because of criticisms from civil society that it lacks democratic credentials to preside over a regional organization designed to promote and enforce them. Swaziland is an absolute monarchy with a dual system of governance between the traditional and the modern. It has elections every 5 years like any other country, but it is the only member of SADC that doesn't allow political parties to form or to participate in elections. It is also very well documented that the Swaziland political system, which is called the Tinkundla, violates freedoms fundamental to a democratic polity. It is also well documented that under this Tinkundla system, human rights abuses and arbitrary arrests of pro-democracy activists have continued for many years. Swaziland has also been critiqued for spending millions on the summit, on the event of the SADC summit, given that its economy is perpetually struggling and that socioeconomic development has been very low on the agenda of Swaziland at the domestic level. 63% of its 1.2 million citizens live below the poverty line. Half the population of Swaziland is young, with an average of 21 years. It is interesting that a government that has suffered severe liquidity crisis in past years now is saying that the main thing that it will be focusing on as SADC chair is resource mobilization. And this will be resource mobilization for SADC and SADC projects. Swaziland intends to be raising money from the member states of SADC and the wider donor community. How this resource mobilization focus of Swaziland as chair will pan itself out remains to be seen. We know that Swaziland has struggled to raise money for itself from traditional donors, but we've also observed that it is raising money elsewhere. It has adopted a look east policy that seems to be working here and there. I want to just add that criticisms concerning the democratic credentials of SADC chairs are not new. Angola and Zimbabwe were similarly criticized when they chaired SADC in 2011 and 2014, respectively. For the most part, when there is a perceived weakness or shortcoming in a chair of SADC, the role of the incoming chairs become very important. So Angola and South Africa are therefore well positioned to provide support and lead from behind in such a scenario. I want to highlight five substantive issues that will also affect the overall running of SADC as an organization and have an impact on its ability and capacity to lead in peace and security issues in the region. These issues were discussed at length at the last SADC summit in Swaziland. The first issue concerns money, in particular, the annual contributions from member states that help fund SADC operations and activities. And this includes all the activities in relation to mediation, goodwill missions, and different interventions in Lesotho, Madagascar, and the DRC. SADC depends on its member states to honor their contributions. But sometimes contributions are very late, making planning and early response very difficult. Contributions are also very unpredictable because they're based on the GDP performance of SADC member states, which of course varies from one member state to another, and it changes year on year. SADC also relies heavily on donors to fund its operations. The current percentage of donor funding stands at 79%. Donor funding and the reliance of SADC on donor money is not only a problem for them in terms of their ability to plan ahead and respond in crises, it also compromises the ownership and sustainability of SADC programs. So at the last SADC summit, there was a lot of talk about lessening the organization's dependency on donors. And a decision was made to operationalize what they refer to as a SADC Regional Development Fund as one of the first steps to lessen donor dependency. Another decision that was made to operationalize something was to operationalize the SADC Administrative Tribunal. This is, as you predicted, a downgraded SADC tribunal, because we know that the powers were taken away in 2014. The SADC Administrative Tribunal, the new one, the downgraded one, is a tribunal without a lot of powers. It doesn't have jurisdiction, for instance, to hear cases brought by individual citizens against their governments. SADC also received a request from the SADC Parliamentary Forum last year, advocating that it be transformed into a legislative arm of SADC, called the SADC Parliament. The request was not approved. And that's it. The position of SADC is that this request cannot be taken forward, and the possibility of SADC Parliament playing a stronger legislative advisory and oversight role over SADC, the SADC body, is not a reality that is going to take place anytime soon. Finally, the SADC summit approved and re-endorsed Botswana Foreign Affairs Minister Dr. Pelonomi Vincent Montoi's candidacy as the SADC candidate for running for the AU chair position in January. What is different, however, from the conversation about re-endorsing Dr. Moitoi to run again as a SADC candidature for the AU elections, is that Botswana has now been asked to give SADC a comprehensive strategy for how they're going to lobby the AU members so that the candidacy of Mevensen is successful. But I didn't have a strong strategy at all. You didn't even have a strategy. And as we know, the outcome of the elections was that she did not get the required two-thirds majority from the rounds. The voting rounds at the last AU summit. So Botswana is expected to come up with a strong strategy that will help the region support it. It cannot depend on South Africa to support its lobbying. And now moving to the biggest topic that has occupied the SADC security agenda for the last 2 years, which is Lesotho. At the last summit, the SADC facilitator, South African Deputy President Cyril Ramaphosa, presented the government of Lesotho's progress report on the implementation of reforms as outlined in the SADC Pumapi Commission of Inquiry recommendations. I'll be frank, my analysis of what government has presented as progress is that it falls far short of what is required to address the cyclical political and security instability in Lesotho. I don't think the government of Lesotho is taking the SADC recommendations seriously. The government is simply buying time and wants to maintain the status quo. Why do I say this? Because so far, what the government has done is that it convened a security sector reform workshop. It actually convened it with SADC, with support from the SADC Secretariat. But the whole workshop was closed. There was no civil society organizations were represented there. Nobody really knows what is going on except for the government. It's a very top-down process. Similarly, what is a top-down process is the process of designing a new constitution for the government of Lesotho. They are supposed to do a kind of a constitutional reform process initiative, and of course we know that that cannot be done by government alone. It is something that concerns Basotho in their entirety, civil society organizations and the opposition, which actually remains in exile. So again, something that is of national interest is being done in a very closed manner, and there is no access to information. They're not sharing it, and there are concerns that it will collapse because it doesn't have broader ownership. A lot of the recommendations that have been made in the PUMAP report have not been implemented by the government of Lesotho. Most importantly, this includes the removal of the country's general of the Lesotho Defense Forces, General Kamudi, the same person who was, by the way, fingered by the previous prime minister for attempting a coup and attempting to eliminate him in 2014. He's still at the helm of the Lesotho Defense Forces. He was reinstated by the current government. He is not. He hasn't been removed as per the recommendations of the SADC Commission of Inquiry, who found that his remaining there was causing a polarization within the security structures. Another recommendation that has not been implemented at all by the Lesotho government is the criminal investigations into the death, the killing of the former general Mahau under the previous general Kamudi's watch, basically. The recommendations from the SADC Commission of Inquiry was that the situation be investigated because it is such an anomaly in any country that a general is murdered, is killed by his peers, and there's absolutely no criminal investigation to it. In fact, it is kind of perpetuating impunity in the way that political hits or situations of this nature are handled. What also has not been discussed or even considered by the Lesotho government is the recommendation that they release the 23 soldiers from prison that were charged with mutiny. Many people refer to these charges as fake charges. As we know, the date of the charges coincided with the date when the head of the Lesotho Defense Forces was accused with a coup. A coup coinciding with a mutiny. This is the reality. The recommendation from the SADC Commission of Inquiry was that the soldiers be released and an amnesty be granted. The other recommendation that one can conclude to say that government has invalidated it as an important consideration is the return of exiles. The opposition remains in exile, and it's not only them, it's soldiers from the time that Mahau was killed that left Lesotho and were exiled in South Africa. There's an impasse, a stalemate over the return of the exiled opposition, because their big demand is that they cannot return to Lesotho if Kamudi is still at the helm of the Lesotho Defense Forces. They want Kamudi to be removed first and security guarantees to be given to them by SADC, and that on that basis, they will assess the environment, whether it's conducive for their return, and make a determination from there. They still remain outside Lesotho, as Lesotho is going on the business of reforming the security forces and reforming the constitution. One of the biggest problems with a lack of movement on the recommendations from the Lesotho side and a lack of traction on the other hand, in terms of putting more pressure on Lesotho to implement the recommendations from SADC, is that SADC still has no visibility on the ground in Lesotho. The Oversight Committee, which was recommended last year to be deployed in Lesotho and act as a warning in early warning mechanism, and liaison between the Secretariat and Lesotho is yet to be deployed. There's absolutely no visibility of SADC on the ground. This is not a situation that is specific to the Lesotho mission only. It is also a challenge that SADC has in its facilitation and mediations in the DRC and also in Madagascar. The last thing I will say on Lesotho is that Lesotho now survives on extensions. It has been given another extension by SADC for October the 30th, where the SADC body is expected to receive another progress report from the government in terms of the implementation of the recommendations that are outstanding. Now, finally, on Madagascar and the DRC. SADC Special Envoy to Madagascar is former President, Mozambican President Chissano. He had a mission to Madagascar in September last year, which was led by the former Foreign Affairs Minister of Mozambique, Simão. And they had another follow-up mission just 2 weeks before the SADC summit. And within this mission, they met all the stakeholders, including the current president, the former presidents, and the opposition. There are so many outstanding issues in Madagascar in terms of the implementation of the SADC roadmap in Madagascar. That is the basis within which the envoy is engaging the Madagascar stakeholders. So where we are now is that the two missions have been concluded. They have to be concluded in line with the SADC roadmap in Madagascar. And they have to then take stock of the outstanding issues. One of the outstanding issues, of course, is the issue of national dialogue, the issue of national reconciliation in Madagascar that has to be strengthened from the part of SADC. The report of the special envoy will be presented to the SADC organ in due course. I think they've been given a timeline of about 3 weeks because the mission took place 2 weeks just before the summit. So that's where we are with the summit. The resolution on Madagascar is just to strengthen the SADC envoy's work and also to see opportunities for reinvigorating the SADC Madagascar liaison office. There was a liaison office that was opened 4 years ago, and then it was closed because of funding. It really was a very strategic office because it provided that very strong entry in the Secretariat and Madagascar. And it was also very good in helping the SADC Special Envoy to understand some of the issues that may crop up in between their missions. And then a last resolution on Madagascar is about really SADC to try to find strategic entry points to support Madagascar's national development. You know, Madagascar's history of political instability and the coups, the poverty levels, the fact that it's not an attractive destination for investors, for example, because of the instability. It has really hit hard on the performance of the country's economy. And there's now an effort, there's an international collaborative effort to help raise resources and for Madagascar, and also raise its profile as a stable and viable destination for investors. So there is going to be a national Madagascar Donors and Investors Conference, which will take place in October in Paris, France. The SADC Summit has made a recommendation that SADC representatives from the Secretariat be there to support the process and give it that regional credibility, you know, so that it's not seen as a donor led program, and then the whole conversation about donors imposing themselves in the affairs of Madagascar is revived. Now moving on to the DRC. On the DRC, the discussions at the summit were mainly to encourage and endorse ongoing initiatives spearheaded especially by the international community and the African Union on the ground. So when you look at, when you read the breadth of the minutes, it lends its support to the renewal of the MONUSCO mandate in the DRC to 2017. SADC lends its support also to the national inclusive dialogue that has been facilitated by the AU Special Envoy Kocho. But I think there is need for SADC to define its role here. SADC is missing in its support, visible support in the national dialogue. Of course, the main challenge for SADC's involvement here is that there's a lot of strong, visible players on the ground, and so it has to define its niche very well. It also is coming a little bit last, so I think there is an apprehension that it doesn't impose itself overly too much, but it finds a way that it can its support can be complementary to what is already on the ground. So in this instance, as we know, the ICGLR has been also very strong in encouraging especially political dialogue on the part of the government, having hosted a couple of summits with the DRC government, and also because of the strong role that Angola plays in the ICGLR, and Angola being a strong ally of the DRC. So there is a SADC ICGLR kind of partnership in engaging on the in the DRC. SADC will host a joint SADC ICGLR summit in coming weeks in this respect. But very lastly, what SADC will do, as obviously the conversations around the electoral calendar, the electoral register in the DRC cannot be ignored. And SADC does have bodies that can be deployed to the DRC that are focusing on the readiness of the DRC to hold elections. In this respect, SADC will deploy a mission from its SADC Election Advisory Council in coming weeks again. The mission will be deployed to do an assessment of the dynamics on the ground on the basis of the report of that mission and the recommendations it makes. SADC will then take a stronger position on how the future of its engagement on the DRC will look like.